welcome. Today I'm going to do we're going to do a session with someone who's trained the who's who of Hyderabad into fitness, and it's a real it's a very, very honorable moment for us that someone who's not just living the life but someone who's training who's who are the pillars of Hyderabad is here with us today. And let's welcome Ruhee today. So how has your journey been? I mean, you know, can you share how have you started off your fitness journey? What inspired you to take care of your body?
I started at the age of 16.
Wow.
And I was a plump kid, and every time you went to a store, you would look at a size and say, you know, I think I want to get into a smaller size.
Mm.
And that's when I said to myself that when I go to into a store, I don't want to check the size.
Mm.
If I like something, I should fit into it.
Wow. So that's when you decided?
That's when I decided that fitness is going to be my first baby.
Mm. Wow, fitness is the first baby.
Yeah.
Awesome. So Ruhee, not just like even with your very, very busy life, you know, with you training clients throughout the day or whenever you do it, do you take time to work out on a regular basis?
Yes, I do. Mm. Because
and how important it is to do that?
Being a trainer, it's very important to have your own workout regime, because when you train others, it helps you to understand the body. Until you do not feel, I'm someone who is a person, a feeling person. So if I don't feel what is happening with my body, whether it's good, bad, it's ugly, it's painful, it's fearful, until I don't experience it, I'm not being able to share it and be convinced. I need to be convinced and talk you into it. So if I'm not convinced, I can't be a good trainer.
Right. So that's why you feel that.
So that is why it's important that I work with my own body. I have my own practice. It's very important to have your own time of practice, because it's like your own little meditation, your own personal time. Any relationship needs time to spend with. You spend time with your children, with your parents, with your spouse, with your girlfriend, boyfriend, with your boss. Anyone you're trying to build a relationship with, you spend time. So in the same manner, it's very important that you spend time with yourself.
Hmm.
For you to know yourself, for you to get better with yourself. If you don't spend time and don't work out, when I say work out, I don't mean, it sounds very cliche when you say work out. Everyone's like, oh, you need to hit a gym, you need to do this. No, it's not about only hitting the gym. So it's very wholesome workout when you say you work out with your body, you work out with your mind, you work out with your heart, you work out with your emotions. So it's a wholesome time spending, which is important for yourself, and it's beneficial to everyone who comes in touch with you.
Right. So when you say everyone who comes in touch with you, can you explain that a little more clearly for our mothers? Because most of the time, our mothers are going out and doing things for others. They're very good at doing things for others, but they don't realize the importance of doing things for themselves so that it would enhance the relationship that they have with others. You know, it's a very beautiful synergy, but they don't understand that missing link. They're going out and giving, but they don't realize that, okay, coming back and working on yourself, you'd be able to do so much more better. So
true.
Can you explain that for our mothers?
Now, we would go back to saying that if I didn't have enough of money,
mm.
I wouldn't be able to donate.
Mm.
Okay, now, spending time with yourself is filling your own cup.
Mm.
Now, if you fill your cup and if it's overflowing, you know, in fact, instead of you dipping in and giving it out, because that would really somewhere drain you.
Yeah.
And you will not even realize that. Mm. Like, we have the older generation, mm. which drained themselves.
Right.
They literally didn't live for themselves. Mm. They lived for their children, for their families. They lived for everyone else. And as they grew older, they grew more insecure.
Mm.
They grew more, you know, the older ones of the older generation are a bit harsh.
Mm.
Because they have not lived life,
mm.
they have given because that was the way to do it.
Right.
But somewhere when children move ahead, there's this little kind of loneliness and bitterness. And they also, you know, there's a very famous saying that Indian parents give very good roots, but they don't give wings.
Wow, that's so beautiful.
They don't give wings because they are worried that the children are going to fly away. And there's no source to their happiness. Because all their life, they drew their happiness from watching else, from watching what someone else gave them. So if that one person who gave you happiness flew away, you would not know how to exist. So it's important that today, in today's day and age, that if I give myself that 1 hour or 2 hours to do my own thing, I would grow with my family. So at the end of the day, if they even didn't bother to come home or didn't bother to call me, I'd not be so upset.
Right.
Because the 2 hours I didn't kind of invest in them, I invested in myself.
Right, true.
So it's very important that you also grow with them. So even as they are ready to leave your nest, you will be happy for them. You will not worry for them. Because somewhere deep down, you have also grown with them.
Right.
Like, you know, and yeah, it's important to grow along with each other. Otherwise, kadi chhod jati hai.
Right. That's so beautifully put, because we don't understand the difference. And also at the society, like you said, they eulogize people who sacrifice everything.
Yes.
And they think that, you know, they, somewhere it's fed into our minds that you sacrifice everything, you do this, you are like one Mahan Devata, or you are like amazing person and all of that.
And you know, if one generation has done it, and if you're trying to break it, then you're a black sheep.
Exactly.
You're like, this is not the way to bring up children. I didn't bring you up like this. I gave you all my time. I did everything for you. Because somewhere they're justifying what they did with their life.
True.
And you know, somewhere the older ones look at you and say, hey, I could have also done it differently.
Right.
You know, so the message goes out to the ones who can do it differently now.
Right.
Don't wait till you go there and look at your children, do it and say, I could have done it.
Right.
Just do it for yourself that I can be different.
Right. Awesome. Very beautifully put. So another thing is, you know, we have this, like, you know, in some of the very traditional families, most of the 80% of the families, but they think, okay, the moment you give birth, you know, you need to take a break. Like a break from career, break from, you can't manage a career as well as your kids at the same time. You know, it's like, oh, kids become everything. Oh, why do you have to earn money? You don't need to go out and earn money.
I've heard that a lot of times.
Yeah, you know.
You don't need to do this.
Yeah. Your husband is making good enough money.
Yeah.
Why do you have to do this, you know?
Yeah.
So,
I've heard that a lot.
Yeah, right? So, what would you say to people like that? Where it's definitely not a need. Like, whether you are working or I'm working, we are not doing this to get out and get money.
Yeah.
There's something much more deeper than all of that. So for someone who's been told that, you know, where you don't have to work for money, you just take care of the kids, more than enough.
Yeah, but the fact is that I love children, okay? And I love my kids to the core, but I recognize that if I can love myself, I will love them even more. Okay, if I have to do things for them, I will do it for them. But the next time I will see that it is my turn. And then they have to wait on me. I wait on you and you wait on me. So that as we grow together, like I said earlier, it's very important. And for me, I was a working person before I had my children. And then I took a break. I did also take a break because I have two children. I have two sons. And they're just 1.5 years apart.
Just like mine.
They're both C-section babies.
Okay.
And yes, they both did have a medical history when they were born. But as soon as my elder one was 3 and the younger one was 1.5, I said to my husband that, you know, women will generally go to a parlor, they will go out for movies, they'll go out to a kitty, they will do something, you know, you will just go out and go for a walk for 1 hour. And I said to him, you know, I love my job and I will step out for that 1 hour to teach. Because I said to him that if I am happy and if I am full, this home will overflow.
Right.
Because they draw, your kids, your family draws from you.
Right, true.
You are the root. So you got to let your roots go deeper. The deeper the roots go, the taller the tree, the thicker the tree, the healthier the tree. You know, and that tree will give you beautiful fruits.
True.
And I said to him that it's going to be 3 hours in a week. I'm just going to start off very gradually. And it's been 6 years now. My kid is 9. And today it's like, matter of fact, yeah, she's stepping out for work. You know, and then I say to him, and he said to me once, my elder one does have this thing that, you know, Ma, there are other parents who are always with them. And there are other mothers who will stand down and as they play, they will stare at them. So he actually comes down and says this to me, and I look at him and I'm like, are you actually saying that to me? So I said to him, I was actually amused at his question, and I said to him, son, if I stand every day and just watch you play, it's a journey for me and it's a journey for you. And after some time, I have personally seen that children who you give too much attention to begin to take you for granted. You know, because my mom would say, the driver goes to drop my children and the driver goes to pick up my children. So as soon as they leave, I leave also with them. I give them a tiffin, I make their breakfast, I dress them in the morning and I leave with them. Now the 1 hour, if I have to go to drop them and pick them up, there's nothing going to change if they go with the driver.
Right.
Okay, nothing's going to change if they go by school bus. But it helps me because I'm being a trainer, that is my time for work. So when they leave at that time, I tell him, son, okay, there was a week where I didn't have work. So my mom was after me, why can't you go drop them? Why can't you go pick them up like other mothers? And I said, okay, let me see. And she went and I went along with her first day. Oh, they were excited. Mom came. Second day, ha, mom came. Third day, he's like, ah, so what? She's there. And I knew that was that, but I needed to tell my mother that.
Right.
Because it's the ones who are right around you who will have a problem with what you do. Because she would have picked me up and she would have dropped me all my life.
Right, right.
And she also worked.
Right.
It's not that she did it any differently. You know? So I said to her, look what he just said. I don't want him growing up and saying that you just did nothing. I didn't tell you to sit back. I've also seen my students' parents who, the students' mothers who stay at home, after a while, when the kids are about 13, 14, they'll come home and say, Ma, you don't know anything, you're sitting in the house the whole day. But if there's a mom's friend who works, then what auntie says is correct. But what mom says is rubbish. And mom's the one who's made all the sacrifices.
True.
Mom's the one who makes everything go around for you.
True.
So I don't give my kids 100%. I love them 100%, but I feel that the fire comes when you withhold. When the thirst is there, you will be an achiever. I'm an achiever because I thirsted for it. Like I said, when I walk into a store, I don't want to check a size. If I like something, I should fit into it. That was it. So I want my kids, today's kids get everything.
True.
On a platter. I mean, the even if the t-shirt is not old, we will carry and say, oh, it's time to detox. And we let go of it. So there is never a scarcity. There's never a, they don't know what is lesser.
Right.
They don't know what is hunger.
Right.
They don't know what is thirst. Because you have a maid carrying the bottle around the child.
Yeah, true.
So, I carried a bottle, I carried a feed, I carried a big baby bag till they were 4 and a half, 5. When my younger one turned 6, I stopped carrying everything. Mm. And they would say, I want to pee. I would say, hold it. As soon as we go to auntie's house, you can get down and go pee.
Mm.
Say, I'm thirsty. I say, hold it. You should learn to hold your thirst because I'm making my children aware. I'm not just feeding them fish. I'm teaching them how to fish.
Right. So that's where most of us miss out on. We think we have to give the best to the child. But what best is something which is being taken for granted. And then you don't understand, oh, I have done so much, but you know.
When you say I've given the best, you should look back at your own self and say that what is it that made me? You know, my husband and me both, I'm very glad, are on the same page because I say to him that we were both hungry. We were both thirsty. So we achieved. Then you have the fire in your belly. But when you're given everything, this is something that I didn't have, so I have it now. I'm giving my child what I didn't have. Am I giving my child what I had?
Right, true. That's beautiful, yeah.
I'm not giving my child that what I had, the experiences that I had, the hardships that I was put through. See, there are a lot of people who would disagree with me, but I'm one of the parents who believes that, guys, hold it, you will get there, you work hard for it.
Right.
Like my son, he comes home and he tells me when my husband's movie released, and we actually keep the children very away from the industry, but school on a very large, I don't say school, but the parents at school would actually tell their children to go up to the kids and say, hey, you know, tell this guy your dad's famous. Actually, and like he would come home, yeah, my first year old, you know, in this first grade, second year old would come home and say, Dad, are you famous?
Oh.
And Dad and me would look at him and say, where did you hear that? And say, you know, so-and-so said this. And so we would ask him, who said that? Say, his parents said to him that go and ask that child. That child, too, they would come home and say, Dada, you know who killed Bahubali? And Senthil would be like, what did you just say? Where did you hear that? And for a while, what happened is they began to get aware that their father is famous. And one day what happened is I asked my elder one, son, who is a popular kid in class? So he said, so-and-so is a popular kid in class. So I said, why do you think he's popular? And he said, you know, because he's very good in his studies, he's this, he's that. And he said, but my father is popular. So I said to him, son, your father is popular, so then you should also be popular.
Right.
But the one who's working hard and the one who's an achiever is popular. So your father, your mother can be anybody they are. It doesn't make you who you are. It's only a platform. And sometimes that platform is too heavy. It doesn't always work on your advantage.
Right.
So son, be grateful you have a platform, but you got to work your own way up. And I think as a mother, I do a brilliant job by saying, no, you won't get that. They actually, when they've achieved something, they'll say, can we buy this? And when I get on the net and say, can we look at the price? And they look at me and say, oh my God, it's this much. And I say, I'm sorry. This is the budget you will get your gift in. So you Google and you Amazon and see in that budget what you like, you can take. You will, this is, you haven't achieved that much that I'm going to give you such an expensive gift. I'm sorry.
So both of you are so famous, you know, like you and really busy too. So do you have any caretakers to take care of your children, or does anyone help you with your children, taking care of your children?
No. We, very beginning, we decided that, you know, our fame is where it is, but we also have a commitment to our children. So if we have help, too much of help at home, we'll be socializing too much. And then, you know, it's like 10 ka 11, 11 ka 12, 12 ka 1. So yes, we did, we would have the maid who, a top maid who we would whenever we needed, like a protocol stepping out for both of us is important and it is a part of our jobs.
Mm.
Then we would have a maid who we'd give her some extra money and she'll stay till 10. So our cutoff is 10.
Mm.
We leave the house at 7:30. We are there at the occasion by 8:30. By 9, we leave and by sharp 10, we are home.
Mm.
So 10 is the days where the children sleep late.
Mm.
Otherwise, the kids are into bed by 8:30.
Mm.
And no help, because one is, you begin to see reflections of the maid in your children.
That's so true.
You know, you'll be like, well, where did this reaction come? And then you realize it's the maids.
Mm.
That's your child.
Mm.
They're my genes. I don't want the maids upbringing.
Mm. True.
I haven't given up. I haven't given up my career. I'm earning pretty well.
Mm.
Not to see my children a reflection of the maid.
Right.
Definitely not. So yes, it has been difficult.
Mm.
Because there are so many times where we turn down social events to go to, but I think it's worth it.
Mm, it's worth it.
It's worth it because our kids are still below 10 and another 3-4 years, they'll not want to see our face.
Mm.
I don't want to miss out on their cuddles and kisses.
Right.
You know, because this is, it's time bound.
Mm.
Everything is time bound.
Mm.
And being a teacher, I think balance is the most important thing in your life.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So if you can balance it, well and good.
Yeah, awesome. So can you talk more about protocols that you and your husband have, or you and your kids have? Are there any systems that you have set up to manage things and to run things on their own? Yeah.
Yes.
Do you want to talk about
of
it?
Of course. This is so amazing. We have the latest thing going on where whoever brings a certificate or an award is the head of the house till the next one breaks it.
So they get to decide?
No, it's like if the elder one brought a certificate, he's head of the home till someone else, till the rest three of us bring home a certificate or an award.
Right. So what does the head of the home get to do?
So head of the home gets to say, you don't talk on the phone, we spend time together. The head of the home gets to decide what's in the menu that day.
Mm.
Head of the home gets choice of which movies we go to. Head of the home gets to decide what which restaurant they want to go to.
Right. That's awesome. You know, when I tell people, you know, my older one decided the menu for the next whole week. Like we keep changing our menus for 2 weeks. Like every 2 weeks we change. And he's the one who gets to decide the menu. And he plans what the entire family needs to eat. And he's just 8.5, 9 years now. In July, he's going to be 9.
I think my son is also 9. He just turned 9 in Jan.
Yeah, yeah. So when you're saying this, I feel really happy because I think they're not kids. You know, you should not think, okay, 9-year-old cannot do this.
I have never treated my children as a kid. I remember when my elder one was born, and I would chat with him while he was in my belly.
Mm.
And when he was born, I would hold him like that and talk to him.
Mm.
And Senthil would say, who are you talking to? And I'd say, to my baby. And then he'd say, okay. He always knew I'm different. But in 20 days, he saw him responding.
Right.
And then he's like, I said, he's my baby. He's mine.
Right.
Okay, I can say that very, very proudly that he's mine.
Mm.
And what I see in him has to be mine.
Mm.
I don't see a reflection of anybody else.
Right.
Actually, Senthil and me constantly, we look and say, I say, okay, now this is your quality. And then he'll say, this is you. So it's a very beautiful journey. Another thing that we follow in the house is if there's one person who has a goal to achieve, rest all three of us will fall in line.
Awesome. Awesome. Yeah.
Okay. So if dad has a shoot, we all sleep by 8:30.
Mm.
If the kids have exams, none of us go for a movie.
And that's very important, you know.
It's very important because it's like, we are four leaders in the house.
Mm.
Okay, this is a pack of lions. We are a pack of lions. Okay,
right.
And we move together,
mm.
we love together,
mm.
and we
support each
other.
Yes, that's awesome. You know, because
I completely disagree when people say, okay, it's my career and I need to do this, so I need to move out and the rest can do their thing. I totally don't agree, because there would be big bouts of times where we wouldn't watch a movie because my husband is shooting, he's busy, and he's not much of a social person. He generally loves watching movies and he watches them with us.
Mm.
Now, if we have watched it and come, mm. he doesn't get to watch it.
Right.
So we wait for him to come home. When he's free, we will go for a movie.
That's such a wonderful thing that you said, that, you know, you are a team of people. This is what I tell any of my friends who calls me out or anything. I say I'm a family pack. You know, all four
actually,
of us will come.
I stopped having single friends.
Right.
And I always tell all my friends who have families mm. that it's kind of dangerous.
Mm.
I would use the word dangerous mm. to have single friends.
Mm.
All due respects to the status they have. I have also been there.
Mm.
And, you know, somewhere what happens is that when you look at the freedom that they have, there are times which are very, very stressing. There are times where it's crazy. It's really bad. And then you look at them and say, oh my God, I wish I was there.
Mm-hmm.
And I at no point want that kind of comparison
mm.
because I'm telling you, mm. I'd rather have a house which is messy, full of my children and my family, than have a house which is
spick and span
and not a soul to sit in it.
That's so true.
I remember going to a friend's house, a student's house, and when I walked in and I was like, wow, like breathtaking, and then I was like,
empty.
No, thank you. I'm someone who really watches herself,
mm.
so I'm not envious mm. because what I have, I know is worth.
Mm. Yeah, and even when we meet people, even when we go to friends, how important it is to go meet people with the same philosophy,
mindset,
very important. Values.
You see, when I bring friends home, I'm very particular who I want my children to be exposed to.
Mm.
Very, very particular, very stingy who I invite to my house, because children are innocent.
Mm.
Children, you know, for them, whatever you do is perfect at this stage of their life.
Mm.
So if you have said yes to it, that means this person is perfect.
Mm.
And actually, one of the reasons I also stopped having maids was that maids just walked in and out
mm.
and I'd see my child's heartbreak.
Oh, okay.
And I said, I can't deal with this.
Mm, 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 mm.
It's going to be a hard parenthood, but
right.
I'm all right with
right,
it.
Right, right. Right.
Because children just get fond of maids
right.
for nothing at all
mm.
and that maid doesn't even care.
Mm.
So this is one of the reasons also we chose not to have
True.
Maids.
You know, like I went on a trip with a bunch of friends and all of that. So my son, he goes and he says, you say that guy is nice, you say that guy is your friend, but he's smoking. You said smoking is not good, but you know he's smoking every time. And I didn't notice that guy do that. I don't know where this my son observed that. And he's like, but he's your friend, Mama, and this is bad.
Yes.
So how do
yes.
I
yes.
justify?
How do you justify?
You can't justify.
Yeah. So what I tell my children is that, you know, son, there's nothing right and wrong.
Mm.
There's nothing good and bad.
Mm.
It's everything has its appropriate place and time.
Mm.
So when you grow up, it's the choices that you take and make
as an adult
that will lead to where you need to go.
Mm.
So as an adult, I chose, your father chose not to drink and smoke.
Mm.
So this is the life we lead.
Mm.
That doesn't mean another uncle or aunt who does that
mm.
becomes good or bad.
Mm.
Because then what we are bringing up is prejudiced children.
Right. Mm.
We are sowing the seed
mm.
that I'm trying to break from my own head, which my parents put.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So I say, just because if someone chooses a habit over another, that doesn't make them good, good. Or bad.
Mm.
So I say to him, when you are old enough, so this means, can I smoke?
Mm.
So I said, when you're 18,
mm. That's your choice.
It's going to be your choice. Mm. And whatever you choose, I may agree or disagree, but I will always love you. Even now, I tell them, you know, sometimes they do things that I don't approve of. And they'll say, so I'm a bad boy. I said, no, it doesn't make you a bad boy. Because there are some things that you feel like doing. Mom can see, mom's sitting up in the sky, you're sitting at a tree. So from the tree, the angle is just that much. But from the sky up there, I can see way ahead that where this behavior of yours will take you. So being a parent, I'm guiding you. Because if I agree to everything you do, that doesn't mean that I love you lesser. Or if I disapprove, doesn't mean I love you lesser. I said to him that when you grow up, you will turn around and ask me, Mom, I was a kid, you were an elder. You knew what was good for me or not. Why didn't you stop me?
Exactly. Right.
So in fact, between both of us, I'm the stricter parent. So, and you know, if you look back at yourself, you will respect the stricter parent more than you will the lenient one.
Totally.
Because you're like, because he was so strict, no, today I've done this in my life.
Exactly. I mean,
so for my children, I'm like, boys, I don't want your love. I want you to be an achiever. Because there's no place for losers in this life. It's not that I'm en route. He comes home and says, Mama, I was second. I said, baby, if you don't have the award, no one's going to notice you. You either have the award or you don't. There's no second place. So in a certain way, I am instilling ambition, but in a grounded manner.
Right. Yeah. So normally it's taken that, you know, even if you have to say I'm very ambitious as a person, or, you know,
It's very negative.
It's very negative.
It's negative.
But I feel ambition is such a positive thing to strive for.
Of course it is.
And I think it has to be cultivated in a child.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you know, so what is your take on ambition and women being ambitious?
I'm a very ambitious woman.
Mm.
And I have strived on a daily basis to get better than what I was yesterday. I'm not in competition with anybody. Okay, if I have friends or anyone comes around me and I know they're being competitive, I will back off. Because boss, that's a cheap game. I'm not interested. Because I think I'm too good. Okay, I'm sorry being pompous, but I am pompous. This is me. I might have a slower pace, but I believe in strengthening my roots.
Right.
I believe in being my roots so strong that when the tree goes up, it goes nowhere but just up. And it stays there with a storm, with a XYZ. So I think it's very healthy to be ambitious.
What's the difference between healthy ambitiousness and a very stifling ambition, which most people consider ambition, they take it in a negative sense.
That's what I'm saying, is that when you ambition with where it comes, where somebody else is there, see, it's very healthy to use someone to get there. As long as you don't hurt the other person.
Awesome. Yes. As long as your ambition is to improve yourself and not to get the other person down.
So every time my son, if he has to say a word, if he has to say a sentence to my younger one, or this one thing I ask him, was that a building statement or was that pulling you down?
Awesome.
And then I don't have to correct him anymore. I only say two things. Was it building or was it pulling it down? And he knows that. So there are some times when he was younger, he would say stuff to me like some random stuff. And I would say, Sanu, what is this? And he'd look at me and say, what did I do? And then I'd say, okay, take yourself, put yourself in that person's shoes and pick that person and put them in your shoes. Because he'll want to play only to win. So I say, playing to win is one thing, but playing to make someone else feel lesser is another thing.
Amazing. That's so beautiful. Yeah.
So I play to win. I'm not playing to make someone else feel lesser. I'm in competition with myself.
Yes.
did I do this better than yesterday? This is one question that I have asked myself always. That, you know, Ruhee, this is the way you reacted yesterday. Don't you think you can get a little better than this? I mean, it's been so many years that you're doing the same thing. And then you're getting the same results. So you do something, you react differently. And then I'm like, okay, I'm getting older. I better spruce up my act.
Senthil is like very, very busy. And, you know, most of the burden falls on the mother in circumstances like that. Yet, you have made your mark and you're just growing. Can you talk more about your work and later on about, you know, how do you manage to be ambitious yet to be able to handle your kids at home and to be growing in both the ways?
It's quite a long question you asked. Like I said,
so first you can talk about your work.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm a yoga trainer.
Yeah.
And it's something that I love doing. I still remember when I started my career first way back in 2003. My yoga guru, Dr. Bharat Thakur, I trained under him, and I moved to Hyderabad 2007 after that. And there was never any looking back. And I remember way back then where, like, everybody says, you know, it's like, okay, now this is the product. Can you sell it, please? And when we just joined him and he'd say, okay, talk about it. And I would just look at him blankly. Like, you can see me lie. I'm so transparent. You can see me lie. And I said to him, until it doesn't change me, I can't sell this. And it has not stopped changing me.
Yes.
It has not stopped changing me, and it never will.
Yes. Yoga has not stopped changing you.
Yes.
Yes. Every single day.
Every client I work with.
Can you talk about your clients?
Way back in Mumbai, we used to train the who's who, because Bharat was known for his celebrity client training. And from Pinky Roshan, I remember, was Hrithik Roshan's mother, was my first client.
Awesome.
And I trained her for 2 years. It was Anil Kapoor's wife. And Satish Kaushik, those years with Mr. India, that had released way back then. And many, many more. Timmy Narang, Kelly Dorji, Lara Datta. We used to have
and
Neha
Kelly Dorji,
Dupia.
Lara Datta are known for their fitness levels.
Exactly.
Right.
So they used to come to class. And so it was a very wholesome journey. Then when I moved here, I trained in different places like Dubai and Chandigarh, Lucknow. I trained with the Subrata Roy Sahara family for 6 months. I trained his wife, and the whole family was being trained. So came here, it was Iliana, and there was Bhumika Chawla herself. There was Vinny, that is Vishnu's wife. There was Kajal Agarwal. Then lately it was Prabhas himself and Tamanna. Then it's also Dr. Reddy, chairman of Apollo Hospitals.
So the biggie of the health industry.
The list is never ending, because you know, we just treat physical health. I'm a wholesome trainer.
Right, right. So how do you manage that career with your children, with a husband who's so damn busy?
Okay, our day starts really early. It starts by 5. Okay, it starts at 5.
And most people are still in bed at that time.
Yes, because all my respects and admiration to my husband. I have never in 12 years have him say, I'm not feeling well, I'm not going to work today.
Wow.
He's never said that. So he's like inspiration in the house. You have to keep up. So we wake up in the morning, and then we have chai together, and then I finish cooking. I cook for my children. Wow. I believe in cooking for my kids. I do not let maids cook for the family. You have to understand that food is the physical part, but the energy. See, love is not only about telling somebody I love you. It's about actions, about things you do for them. You know, I can have a mate cut and chop and all that stuff, but cooking for them is a pleasure. And I know my elder one, after he's quite a foodie, and he'll be like, and he'll look at me and say, I love you. And Senthil will be like, I have competition in the house. I don't know how to say I love you so passionately. So it's and then, like I said, we're done. We finished breakfast. Senthil has left by 5:36. He's gone. He's actually gone. Yes.
Wow.
Because
of his work.
So he's left and gone, and then the kids wake up, and then we had breakfast. We have our bath. We change, and we leave. So my training starts at 8.
Mm.
Okay. If I have to train any of the stars, then I finish a class 5 to 6 and come back.
Wow.
By 6:30, I'm back to wake up my children and send my boys to school. I want to see them off to school.
Mm. Right.
This is a choice I've made. I could have made $1 million.
Mm.
$1 million, and I could have got super famous by now. But for me, it's important to see them off.
Mm.
Important to see them eat well.
Right.
Because then they leave at 8 and they're back home at 4.
Right.
I don't know what they've eaten, what they haven't. Mm.
Right.
You know, so, but at least I know I fed them a wholesome meal
first
in the morning.
Yeah.
And I'm a lovely cook.
Mm.
I research my food.
Mm.
I do lots of different combinations. I'm not a dal chawal kind of person. I'm like, you know, different sabzis and all the different
stuff.
It's an art. It's an art.
It's an art.
And when people say I'm creative by just doing a good painting, is not creativity.
Not true.
You can be creative in everything that you do.
True.
In the way you say I love you can be creative, guys. I mean, creativity is just only what is displayed. Creativity is in everything.
Right.
And then at 8 o'clock I start my training.
Mm.
I train till 12:31. 1 to 4 is my time.
Right.
Is really my time where I would, and in that 12, if I do get my chance, I finish my own training. And then 12:30 to 1 is eat, take a nap, meditate. And be ready for my kids at 4.
Awesome.
Okay, my kids at 4, and then again I leave by 4:45 for my next training session in the evenings. And that's it. Then I'm back again home by 7:30 to feed the children and be home and have dinner together.
Right. Awesome. So if a mother wants to take up fitness as her journey, you know, like get into this field, what are the benefits of getting into the industry of fitness? What are the benefits, especially for someone who's never done it all her life, but now, because she doesn't want to do an IT job, which is like, you know, which is going to take you away from home, instead of doing nothing, if she can even start off with her own fitness and get into this as a profession, what would you suggest someone like that?
I would first suggest you to do a course.
Course, yeah.
You know, because creativity is one part, but having your basics right. Is another part. Okay, now there are people who have their knowledge but they are very bad at communicating it.
True.
So it's a balance of what you study and how you can inculcate it into your own practice. First you do your course, then you work on yourself. And when I say self, I just don't mean body. I mean every layer of you. You work on yourself completely. And then when you can, once you know I'm ready, and you know, you can never be ready.
You can never be ready.
You know that.
You never want to leave the house.
You never want to leave the house because one, you're so comfortable and secure in the four walls that you have created. It's your comfort zone of not being thrown at a remark. But when you step out and go there,
and you face the world,
you look at there and say, oh my God, these guys have practiced so much. They are younger than me. They are fitter than me. They talk better than me. But you have your bundle of what I could say is experience that you would have nurtured your children, your family. You can bring it into nurturing people that you teach.
Awesome. That's so beautiful. Yeah.
That is... that a young trainer can't have.
True.
You know, it's like we were trained to teach pregnant women.
Right.
And I had a couple of clients before I got pregnant myself. But after my 2 deliveries, my approach is wholesome.
Right.
You know, it is, this part stays. But there's another aspect of knowing what she's going through. Of knowing where the boat's going to tilt.
True.
So that is something a trainer who hasn't been pregnant can't take from me.
Right. Right.
You can be slimmer, you can be tauter, and you can be tighter. But you can't take from me my experience.
Right. Of being a mom. Beautiful. Thank you so much, Ruhi. It has been like so beautifully informative,
so beautiful.
And
thank
empowering.
Yes.
And the way you have defined ambition, it's really beautiful, because a lot of people don't understand that. And to build that fire in your children,
yeah.
And to manage the family.
I actually tell my children that if you don't have a sufficient role on stage, don't bother me. I'm not going to come to school. I actually tell them my time is precious. I'm not going to come and sit and see you like a laddu in the corner of the stage. I'm used to achievers. You better be an achiever. Time not waste karo. And you know, actually they take me so seriously. Which is so amazing. Your kids gotta take you seriously.
Right.
And if you don't take yourself seriously, he's not gonna take you seriously.
I just want to end it right here,
yeah.
Without me ending, finishing it, because I think that should be the statement that should stay with people, you
yeah.
know. If you don't take yourself seriously,
no one's going to take you seriously. Why?
And
your
most important was, people, your kids themselves are not going to take you seriously.
People are going to take you seriously because they've seen ki tumne kuch nahi kiya. Unko lagta hai tumne khana banaya, ghar mein baithe, saaf kiya, phir se khaye piye, soye, wahi kiya tumne zindagi bhar. They don't know that it is another part of being that. But you need to take yourself seriously. So even for, I have students who are plain housewives, I tell them that even if you do nothing else, you study more.
True.
You enrich yourself.
Right.
You know, at least
enrich yourself.
Enrich yourself.
Yes.
So tum mile ke sath ye khaya piya abhi khana bana diya 11 baj gaye kahi ek class chale gaye fir kitty party mein gaye paisa kharcha kiya fir aaye khaya soya 4 baje bachcha hua. आ गया, खत्म हो गई जिंदगी तुम्हारी. फिर उसने क्या पर्स लिया, चलो यहाँ पे एग्जीबिशन है, यहाँ जाएंगे, वो एग्जीबिशन में खरीदेंगे, उसकी पर्स बेटर है, मेरा घर देखो, यहाँ पे मैंने टेम्पलेट लगाया. हेलो, दैट्स द एंड ऑफ योर वर्ल्ड. आई मीन, नो जजमेंट्स,
या इट्स
परफेक्टली सी फॉर यू, मे बी दैट इज व्हाट एक्साइट्स यू, बट हैज इट एनरिच्ड यू? दैट्स व्हाट्स इंपॉर्टेंट.
The 21 Days Challenge. Log into www.millionmoms.in. For more details, contact 77024-9110.